Jane, thank you very much for that introduction. And ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be with you this morning. I'm very struck by the logo on your conference website, Minds, Meaning, Metrics, Consumer Understanding in an Uncertain World. And the reason it strikes me is because it goes right to the heart of strategy, of operations, of tactics. And indeed, if you remove the words metric and consumer, that logo summarizes the problems faced by the makers and implementers of strategy as they confront the challenges of the day. Minds, meaning, and understanding in an uncertain world is therefore fundamental to strategy makers. You can't design strategy, let alone implement it, unless you understand the minds of the people, the environment, and the landscape you're operating in. Well, in the next 25 minutes or so, I'm going to go from the general to the specific. I'm going to start with a look at the strategic context and the implications of that context for the makers and of implementers of strategy and how they tackle the decisions that they are faced with, or how one might tackle the decisions one is faced with. Then I'm going to look at what I think are the two major strategic defense and security challenges we in the West face. And finally, in a response to a question posed by your conference organizers, I'm going to go right down to ground level and look at a small NGO called Genderforce to give you an example of how information is collated about gender-based violence in remote areas and among vulnerable people. Well, first, the strategic context. And I think we can identify a number of enduring features. In particular, NATO, the European Union, and indeed the global security environment remains in fluid transition, addressing insecurity associated with a perception of unsolvable 21st century challenges and a global economy that is still, in many cases, particularly in some of the Eurozone countries, digesting the consequences of the financial and economic crisis which hit us nearly 7 years ago. Second, the cost of security is increasing. And at the same time, the tools for producing security and stability in the 21st century are viewed by our publics as increasingly ineffective. So the gap between the resources applied and the security realized is a security gap, an effectiveness gap, and a credibility gap. And it's within this gap of costs and decreasing effectiveness that new approaches, a more comprehensive approach, wider partnerships, can help narrow the gap in the short term. And I'll come back to that point upon partnerships later. Next, the complexity of modern security problems is matched by a perceived entropy in the global security system. The majority of our capabilities do not align with the problems we're facing or will face. They were set up to deal with yesterday's problems. The question that poses is, are we capable of adapting them? Then our solutions today, our actions and or inaction, can produce second or third order effects that create new security problems that eclipse the gravity of the original problem we had hoped to solve. And an obvious example of this, of course, is Libya. Well, linked to this is a feature which I fear is becoming increasingly enduring among Western political leaders, a reluctance to do what needs to be done, a hope that by burying heads in the sand, the problems will go away, and a preference for short-term political expediency over long-term strategic solutions. Finally, and perhaps most relevant for this conference, despite the outlays of financial and human resources, security problems persist and are multiplying in both number and complexity. And the world reflects Clausewitz's description of the nature of war, the province of danger, exertion, uncertainty, and chance. Syria, Iraq, Libya, Afghanistan, Ukraine, Gaza, Palestine, Islamic State, the list goes on. And the character of conflict defies neat categorization into a spectrum from high intensity to traditional peacekeeping operations. What we see is a kaleidoscope in which major combat operations, insurgency, terrorism, and organized crime are all part of a dynamic and hybrid combination. And in this complex hybrid kaleidoscope, the minds of the people among whom we operate becomes the vital ground. So we need to subject everything we do to one overriding criterion. What impact is what I'm about to do going to have on the minds of the people amongst whom I'm operating? Because securing the minds and support of the people among whom we're operating is the key activity. If by the way we do things, the way we conduct our operations, we alienate the people, then we gift the advantage to our adversaries. So protection of the people means people-centric campaign design. And that means understanding how the people among whom we operate are thinking. And it's the human dimension, which means that strategy will in practice always remain an art, underpinned but not driven by calculation. An intellectual construct linking where we are today with where we want to be tomorrow in a substantive, concrete manner. It's about integrating the complex calculus of ends, ways, and means. Now, in practice, these are rarely fixed, as events may change the context and objectives of original decisions. In conflict, and although less dangerous, in business too, strategy is inherently adversarial, and the ways and means must be adjusted to account for an opponent's actions. The reality, too, is that means are not limitless, so strategy is often as much means-driven as ends-driven. And when I say ends, I don't mean so much a finite end in itself. Rather, I mean the direction of travel, the path we want to follow. And the relationship between the ends and the ways and means by which we achieve those ends is unstable, and therefore it must be managed proactively and dynamically. And if the means are insufficient to execute the ways required to achieve the direction, then either the ways or the direction needs to be adjusted to meet the means available. And this constant adjustment of the tiller to trim the boat is one of the primary roles of a strategic leader. But strategic leadership requires other and higher skills, for simple rules or principles of leadership and templates of decision-making do not necessarily serve one well in complex situations where there are no right answers, just limited choices between the least wrong ones. So clarity of thought, vision, and adaptability exemplify the strategic leader as much as resolution and determination. An ability to live with ambiguity and uncertainty, and not least a pragmatic capacity to take calculated risk for the longer term and greater benefit, distinguish the successful strategic leader from the tactical operator. Well, the first step in formulating strategy is an understanding of the nature of the problem and whether and how our strategy will alter the dynamics of that problem. This means understanding the environment in which we are or will be operating and the political, the diplomatic, the security, the economic, the social, the infrastructure issues which will affect our strategy. And above all, it is the human inhabitants that make the environment strategic. This reality demands a deep understanding of all actors involved, states, organizations, social groupings, tribal dynamics, as well as individuals, together with their associated characteristics, aspirations, intentions, and limitations. We can make no assumption about rational behavior, for the actors in this drama are human beings whose behavior is driven more by emotional responses, sometimes subconsciously. And so we come back to your logo, minds, meaning, and understanding in an uncertain world. So what you do in the Market Research Society is really important to the formulation of strategy because it's the evidence you provide which is key to understanding the actors involved and therefore key to the decisions taken. Indeed, I'd take that point further and say that there's a role for the sort of research you do as NATO seeks to think, plan, and act strategically. I used to use, at one stage in a past life, use polling companies in Iraq to think, to test the attitudes to security and coalition forces. So why not the use, for example, of market research in formulating security and defense policy in an international organization like NATO? But ultimately, in my world, how we make decisions depends on both objective and subjective factors. Of course, science has its place in the form of management disciplines, of performance reports, of metrics or targets in helping us to understand where we are and identifying when a decision has to be made, and indeed in providing that evidence. But at the end of the day, decision making is an intuitive process, and it is based on training, education, and experience. Consider what T.E. Lawrence, better known as Lawrence of Arabia, wrote on generalship. The greatest commander of men was he whose intuitions most nearly happened, he wrote. 9/10 of tactics were certain enough to be teachable in schools. But the irrational tenth, the test of generals, was like a kingfisher flashing across the pool. It could be ensured only by instinct, sharpened by thought practicing the stroke, until at the crisis it came naturally, a reflex. Well, inspiring words, not only because of the language which resonates so powerfully, but also because of their essential truth, that in whatever sector you're having to make hard, far-reaching decisions, train for the certainty, the science of what you do, but educate yourself for the uncertainty, the art of what you do. And how you handle that kingfisher moment is dependent on the confidence that comes from experience, based always on character and flair. Well, so much for the strategic context, the formulation of strategy, and some thoughts on decision-making in this complex world where understanding of the human dimension is so important. Let me now move to the specifics of at least two of the geostrategic issues we face. And I start with the situation in eastern Ukraine and the threat posed to our defense in Europe, in Western Europe, by Russia. The reality is that nearly a quarter of a century after the collapse of the Soviet Union, the West faces a greater threat of war in Europe than at any stage, probably even during the Cold War. Because even in the Cold War, even in the Cuban Missile Crisis of 1962, and that was pretty close to the wire, the Politburo was constrained by memories of the Second World War. Now, according to the Kremlin's chief propagandist, Dmitry Kiselyev, who is, incidentally, the man who threatened recently that Russia is the only nation capable of reducing America to radioactive ash, even a decision about nuclear arms, and I quote, will be taken personally by Mr. Putin, who has the undoubted support of the Russian people. Well, bluff or not, this reflects the Russian elite's perception of the West as a threat to the very existence of the Russian state. So as far as defense is concerned, we face a new paradigm in Europe and the West, following Russia's invasion and annexation of the Crimea and the civil war in Ukraine, which have shattered irrevocably post-Cold War assumptions that Russia would steadily democratize and be able to move to a closer partnership with the West. Certainly, the West is guilty, and NATO certainly is guilty of sending ambiguous signals, particularly the promise of NATO membership to Ukraine and Georgia at the Bucharest summit in 2008. But NATO has also been assiduous in attempting to build a partnership with Russia. Perhaps too assiduous, because despite Russian aggression in Georgia in 2008, the West collectively, by returning so quickly to business as usual after that invasion, sent a signal, a green light to Russia, that aggression in its near abroad is okay. But the invasion and annexation of Crimea and subsequent events in Ukraine have shattered any thoughts of partnership. And the reality now is that Russia is a strategic adversary. Russia's buildup of forces on the borders of Ukraine and its continued stabilization of the situation in eastern Ukraine, indeed its invasion of eastern Ukraine with large numbers of military personnel, are clear evidence of this. As is President Putin's bizarre and hyper-nationalistic speech, which he made in the Kremlin a year ago today on the 18th of March 2014, the day Crimea was admitted into the Russian Federation. While not necessarily explicit, and I have to say that some of the language of that speech would not have sounded out of place at Nuremberg in the 1930s. So while not necessarily explicit, the intent is implicit, that what Putin previously described as the greatest disaster of the 20th century, the collapse of the Soviet Union, can only be put right by re-establishing Russian power in the former republics of the near abroad. The pretext, reuniting ethnic Russian speakers under the banner of Mother Russia. Well, such linguistic imperialism, under which Putin claims to owe protection to Russian speakers everywhere, does, of course, pose a direct threat to NATO territorial integrity, notably in the Baltic states, where Latvia and Estonia, and to a lesser extent Lithuania, have significant Russian-speaking populations. So to avoid Russia setting itself on a collision course with NATO, a very strong message needs to be sent, thus far perhaps, but absolutely no further. And for NATO, this means refocusing on collective defense, the foundation on which NATO is built, Article 5 of the Washington Treaty. An attack on one is an attack on all. It means a return to deterrence, both conventional and nuclear. Don't forget the Russians integrate nuclear thinking and weapons absolutely with all their other weaponry. It needs credible, capable armed forces. It means a means to communicate that capability. It means forward defense in the Baltic states. And it means increased defense spending. It also means thinking through what collective defense means in the 21st century. Well, for some time, we have continued to look at Article 5 and collective defense through Cold War lenses. What we've seen recently, though, in Crimea and Ukraine highlights how asymmetric warfare and undercover operations by special forces and the manipulation of the minds of the Russian-speaking minorities, again, back to the people amongst whom we're operating, can undermine the integrity of a state under the radar screen of an Article 5 response without having to invade it, and so potentially cloud decisions over collective defense. I don't see this necessarily as a return to the Cold War. My concern is rather worse than that, because I think we're in a situation not unlike the 1930s, where weak West European democracies, which over the last two decades have effectively disarmed, are now facing a strategic adversary in Russia, which has not only increased its defense spending significantly in recent years. For example, last year its defense spending rose by 18.4%, and this year it's predicated on or expected to increase by 30%. But it's also demonstrated its willingness to change the boundaries of Europe by force under the pretext of the protection of Russian speakers. Well, the parallels with Hitler and his takeover of the Sudetenland in 1938 are too close for comfort. Well, let's leave that one for a moment, as I haven't given you enough gloom and doom. Because the world outside Europe remains a deeply dangerous place as well. If you haven't got a sense of humor, you shouldn't be here, really. The threats we face, particularly terrorism and transnational crime, are not new in themselves. But what is new is the complexity of these threats and their ability to evolve and transform, allowing them to avoid neat categorization and to defy our attempts to combat them. The organizations or movements posing such threats to our interests often shift from one illegal business model to another in order to fund their operations in a dynamic, mutually supporting relationship between criminality and terrorism. The result is that we are engaged in a constant struggle to understand the nature of evolving threats in terms of how they're organized and funded, their command and control relationships, and their methods of coordination and communication. By the time we can gain sufficient levels of understanding to deal with them effectively, our adversaries have transformed themselves again. And we underestimate the resilience, the innovation, and adaptability of these adversaries at our peril. You may recall that in 2011, 2 months after the Abbottabad raid that killed Osama bin Laden, Leon Panetta, then US Secretary for Defense, boasted in Kabul that America was within reach of strategically defeating al-Qaeda. Yet now, as hopes invested in the Arab Spring have withered and died, and indeed as a direct result of the setbacks of the Arab Spring and the consequent chaos, the hydra of al-Qaeda and its many jihadist franchises have shown the resilience to retreat, to reform, to regroup, and to re-establish themselves, and to have staged an extraordinary comeback. And the civil war in Syria has opened a Pandora's box, with the majority of Syria's effective rebel militias now jihadists, with thousands of fighters from other Muslim countries and hundreds from Europe, including, of course, Britain, France, and the Netherlands. And we should expect a significant proportion of these to bring their training experience, contacts, and determination to commit terror acts back home to Europe and America, or even further afield. And the most pernicious of these is Islamic State, a terrorist organization which holds territory has a formed army, or at least the equipment and capabilities of an army, following its capture of several divisions worth of equipment when the Iraqi army collapsed last year, plus a fair amount of the oil wealth to fund their activities. On top of this, it's inspired by what it sees as its divine mission to bring Syria, Iraq, and Lebanon together into a single caliphate, which, if it came to pass, would shatter the post-World War I Middle East borders in the bloodiest possible manner and have dire consequences for our friends in the region, such as Jordan. Elsewhere, other al-Qaeda affiliates are engaged in regional struggles, the most extensive being that of al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb, which seeks to make use of Libya's post-revolutionary chaos and weapons from Gaddafi's regime to create an arc of instability across the Sahara and Sahel. Hence its advice and assistance to Boko Haram in Nigeria and the Shabab in Somalia. As well as the resurgence in jihadist organizations, the al-Qaeda threat has shifted and mutated from that which attacked on 9/11 to more localized threats against Western diplomats, companies, and soft targets. Witness the attacks in Mumbai in 2008, the 2012 attack on a gas installation in eastern Algeria, and more recently, al-Shabaab's attack on the Westgate Mall in Nairobi. While such attacks are easier to plan and execute than blowing up airliners and more attractive to the fighters involved than suicide bombings, and we should expect them to become increasingly frequent, and indeed Westerners working or living in regions where jihadism is strong are doing so at greater risk than ever before. So how do we manage this risk and what should we do about it? First, what we should not do is assume that we can decapitate these networks by airstrikes alone. Airstrikes may have a part to play, but it's dangerous to complacency to talk of defeating a network by killing its leaders, wherever they may be. Second, we must assume that the sort of industrial-sized deployments of hundreds of thousands of Western troops into Muslim states that we've seen in Iraq and Afghanistan are a thing of the past. Only future historians will be able to judge the extent to which they have achieved success. The only long-term solution to preventing and managing these threats is to tackle their root causes while also addressing the fundamental aspects of the environments which allow them to flourish. But the tide can be reversed, and the emphasis should be on supporting weak governments, for example, those in Yemen, Somalia, Iraq, Libya, Mali, and Niger, that are trying to fight the jihadists. Even Kenya and Nigeria could probably do with more help. This doesn't mean a heavy boot print on the ground. Rather, it means assistance with intelligence, logistics, special forces, and air support. But most of all, it means capacity building in the widest sense, because this is not a military problem. Ultimately, it's a political issue. Through building resilience, reduced corruption, improved administrative capacity and capability, governance, law and order, as well as professional armed forces, what I call comprehensive capacity building, in order to apply genuinely integrated approaches across the political, the military, the civilian and commercial interfaces to help train local security forces, modernize administrations, and stabilize economies. In essence, it's all about stabilizing the unstable and so removing the soil in which terrorism flourishes. The best way to manage threats is to prevent them from happening. Solving issues before they reach crisis levels means focusing on horizon scanning, early engagement in areas of concern, and having the capability to address the root causes of instability through capacity building, effectively building upstream security. Of particular importance, we need to develop self-sustainable solutions to regional and local problems, which will involve assisting in the development of appropriate security strategies and then helping to ensure that they're resourced and implemented. But what, you may say, do we do about the chaos in Syria and the monster that is Islamic State? Challenges which have reached crisis levels. The only answer I can give to that is the imperative for an ambitious, internationally agreed and resourced strategy to support regional actors in finding the political solutions and in containing and ultimately excising the problem. Easily said, massively difficult to implement. But if we're serious about the issue, then we have to be prepared to do what needs to be done in helping regional allies and regional countries confront it. So we face a significant challenge in this interconnected, globalized world. We need to regain the initiative against the new terror threats I've touched on, And doing nothing, in my view, is not an option, because they won't limit their activity to far-off countries of which we know little, to paraphrase Chamberlain. And in Trotsky's chilling words, you may not be interested in war, but war is interested in you. Well, let me leave all that gloom and doom for a moment and get right down to ground level and answer a question posed by your conference organizers. Because I want to focus for a moment on Genderforce, a small not-for-profit organization set up by a remarkably energetic and capable Swedish lady, Charlotte Isaacson, to protect vulnerable people from the scourge of sexual and gender-based violence in conflict and post-conflict environments. Here is one lady who recognized that none of us are going to be able to solve all the problems of the world, but she was determined to do something about solving at least one problem. And as Burke said, all it takes for evil to flourish is for good men, and by implication, women, to do nothing. Well, I was asked to join her advisory board because in my last post, I got involved in implementing some of the requirements of UNSCR, United Nations Security Council Resolution 1325, on the whole business of training NATO forces, because that resolution effectively seeks to ban gender-based violence in conflict. Well, the question I was asked is how Genderforce collates information about gender-based violence in difficult areas among vulnerable people. And in answering it, I stress that it's still really early days for Genderforce's first pilot project in the Democratic Republic of the Congo to establish a protection force for vulnerable women and children in northern Kivu. The team, consisting of both gender field advisors as well as security protection specialists, is now deployed and operational and gathering information about sexual and gender-based violence in North Kivu, using a number of tools from the intelligence trade, as well as tried and tested methods from NGOs, journalists, and researchers. Of particular importance has been the establishment of partnerships with other local organizations, with the network, experience, and above all, trust from the people among whom they operate. Human intelligence is also important, and I don't mean here the dodgier end of spying or clandestine methods. Rather, it means finding and recruiting reliable local sources, people on the ground who can use their eyes and report back what is going on. Then there's open source intelligence, intelligence collected from publicly available sources, where there's an abundance of published and available data from credible IOs and non-governmental organizations. Technical intelligence is also important. For example, satellite trackers are used to monitor vulnerable groups of people who can activate an alarm in case of danger. And finally, once a picture is built up, Genderforce will send in a recce team to refine the information gathered from other sources more precisely. The work requires particular skills. Professional self-reliant operators able to keep a low profile, able to network and run informants, a knowledge of local language, culture, and an understanding of the reasons behind the conflict. On top of this, Genderforce operators need a researcher's ability to observe, to interview, to capture and analyze data. So if any of you are interested, please see me afterwards. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to attempt to summarize what I've said. My key message, which I think I've probably hammered hard enough, is that we live in dangerous and difficult times. And if we are to surf the complexity of these times and stay ahead of the waves, we must understand the world we live in, and above all, have the best possible feel for the human terrain we're operating in. And that means insight into people, their hopes, aspirations, and what sets them apart. So what you do, the rigorous research that generates insight and understanding, is really important, not only for business leaders, but also for strategy makers, both nationally and internationally. As market researchers, you have valuable skills which would add real value to organizations like NATO, and NATO itself is very cognizant of the importance of building partnerships with non-traditional stakeholders as it develops and implements strategy. As your conference website puts it, stuttering economies, political upheaval, the world needs insight based on rigorous research. Add to that massive geostrategic threats to our defense and security, and I could not agree with you more. Thank you very much.